our ABS Sport Talk series. We're excited. At all costs, we have some more college recruiting. We have four great panelists here. Starting off right here is Greg Escher. He coached at Georgetown men's basketball for 25 years, 5 years as head coach. He's now a professor at George Mason University, the department chair, and a college commentator for basketball at the Midland Sport Network. To his right is Joe Pereira. He is a former head coach at Old Dominion University in soccer, coached there for 19 years, and all previously coached athletic at Methodist College, where he coached in person to his right, Bethany Berlate. She's a five-time SEC Coach of the Year. She's a national championship winner. She coached a great player named Abby Wambach, maybe you may know her. And to her right is Blake Frohnapfel. He is the quarterback, starting quarterback of the UMass men's football team. And he is a current sport management graduate student. And our moderator is Bob Mercury.
Some of you have had a class, and I never had the opportunity to say Go Gators, so right now I'm just going to say Go Gators. Excited for this panel. Most of the things that we have here are usually situated in professional sports, so it's nice to have something that's situated in the world of college sports. Just starting off, I want to start with all of you and give every single person on this panel an opportunity to answer this question. But thinking about recruits in the past, how have you gone about acquiring recruits?
That is a long answer. I'll give a quick answer of somebody that you all know. And he just was elected into the Basketball Hall of Fame, and I was an assistant coach at the time at Georgetown, and he was a fairly good player for us and a fairly good player for the Philadelphia 76ers, and actually was on the team that lost to UMass when UMass went to the Final Four in Atlanta in 1996. His name was Allen Iverson, and was one of the more unusual recruits that we got. His mother, and this is a true story, most people don't believe it, his mother drove up from Hampton, Virginia, to our offices and asked my boss, John Thompson, will you please take my son? And there were some extenuating circumstances to why she would have to do that. Her son was in jail, and he was also one of the best high school basketball players in the country at the time. And that was clearly a very unusual situation, and the only situation that I've ever been involved in that was like that. Allen was a tremendous player for us for 2 years, and we never had a recruit or dealt with a recruit or dealt with anything like that. So that was a very unusual situation. So I hope, I know that the three people to my right will not have a story like that.
Recruiting is a lifeline of any success in college sports. It is, and we turn every stone. We look for every angle, every opportunity, looking for recruits that would fit the program they were looking for. So when the question is asked, boy, mostly in soccer, it's club, not high school per se. Obviously, most they do go to high school, but we follow the club system, and we go to a lot of events looking for recruits in terms of that. But for the most part, transfers to international, you name it, we're after it. We're looking for it all the time. I will not want to pass.
Perhaps,
the big schools have the means, have the staffing. They basically can do just about anything. The have-nots or wannabes will work hard to maximize what they have and go to events that will maximize their buck or the bang for their buck. The likes of the super conference, for example, they have. Call them the haves. They have the financial resources as well, full staffing to attend just about anything under that. From international to, they will send coaches to evaluate and search out talent. That's our school for most of us, soccer.
Ooh, thanks, Joe, on the half. I think that, probably one of the most interesting stories, since we brought up Abby, was recruiting Abby. She was the National High School Player of the Year when she was a senior in high school, and she could have gone anywhere. And when it came down to it, she was looking at us, UCLA, and North Carolina. And before she even got to that point, her mother, she comes from a very big family, I was the youngest of, I think, seven, and her mother called me and said, I'm making Abby take all five of her visits. She's kind of trying to decide who her last visit's going to be, and she told me this morning that whoever calls her next is going to be her last visit, so call her. I was like, okay. So I called her, she takes a visit, and so we give a big assist to Judy Wambach for that one. But I think one of the interesting things in her recruitment was that because Abby could have gone anywhere, at the time we were a very young program. We had only been in existence for just a couple of years at that point. And we seemed like the odd person out of the equation with her. But if you know anything about Abby, she likes to be different all the time. And so choosing Florida would be a very different decision for her. And I think that actually worked out in our favor in that case. And I think what really helped seal the deal, we were playing North Carolina in the NCAA tournament in her year of deciding, and she was actually visiting North Carolina while we played that NCAA tournament game. We lost, and a lot of our players, you know, as we were walking past their bench to leave, just, you know, said hi to her and stuff. I think she really felt that if the players could go out of the way after basically ending their season, in some cases ending their career, to actually talk to her in that situation, she knew that there was a tight bond there. And I think that actually helps seal the deal.
Typically, I guess I want to change the question up a little bit for you. I want you to talk about initially being recruited and the difference between that process versus once you decided to leave Marshall. Or graduate from Marshall and decide if you want to use those extra years of eligibility.
I would say the recruiting process, you kind of think of it as, you know, hey, I have all these schools looking at me, it's going to be a lot of fun. But in reality, it was really stressful. I was not heavily recruited. I mean, I don't know if you guys know, like, Rivals and 24/7 Sports have a scale from 1 to 5 on your star quality, and I was a 2 star out of 5. I was not highly recruited. I had one FBS offer that was to play at Marshall. I'd say as a quarterback. But the weirdest thing about the whole process is they tell you, hey, you're a number one quarterback, we'd love to have you, but just so you know, we're only taking one quarterback. And so you're thinking, okay, like, if I'm the number one guy, then there's no problem. But there's also, you can look to see both they offered, they've offered 15 other guys. So you think, hey, if I don't take this offer now, then I have no other options. And I actually ended up being offered by Wake Forest as a defensive end, which some of you know that you cannot be further different than more different than your quarterback. And so I was trying to weigh the two back and forth. And so, you know, as an 18-year-old kid, you're trying to make a life-altering decision that you're really not prepared to make. And I visited Wake Forest on a Saturday, and the coach said, we're going to offer your scholarship. Let me know by tomorrow night whether you're coming or not. And so you're thinking, oh, like, he was like, if you don't commit, you can't come. So you're thinking, wow, I'm not ready to make this decision. So I was talking to my parents. They said, hey, you know, Wake Forest is a better school. They play better football. Beautiful area. So I chose Marshall somehow out of that. Decided to go there. And, you know, once I committed, you're thinking, yeah, I'm done. I got that one quarterback spot. So I'm so happy. Like, I'm their guy. And then 1 week before signing day, I signed another quarterback. So I've been committed to them the entire time and take another quarterback. But it's a weird process, and it's different for everybody. You know, I was a guy who wasn't really recruited, so probably I didn't get the same, you know, the extravagant signing day ceremonies and things like that. But for an 18-year-old kid, 17-year-old kid, it definitely very stressful times.
And along those same lines, it seems like just about everyone mentions something about the parents. Either you, like, talking about how you spoke with your parents about it. I'm talking about how everyone likes mom was involved in the process and calling you up. And even Craig, you mentioned the fact that Allen Iverson's mom riding down. So talk a little bit about the parents' influence, and I wanna hear how they manage the process and how you manage your parents. Because I think part of the process is you're managing your relationship with the athlete, but you're having to consider the parent as well. Yeah.
Okay, well, this is a very interesting question in our sport. In women's soccer right now, I don't know how many of you guys know this, but recruiting is, like, kind of ridiculous. What I mean by that is kids are committing when they're freshmen or sophomores in high school. And for the most part, although it's starting to change a little bit too, they stick with those commitments. So you're dealing with a 14 or 15-year-old. So if you think the 18-year-old felt stressed or wasn't ready to make a decision, try carrying on like a meaningful conversation with a 14 or 15-year-old. And so for me, at least, it's a little easier, I think, because, you know, I'm a woman and they're a girl. You can talk about, like, you know, prom and, well, they're not even going to prom yet. They're not even driving license yet, you know? But, like, imagine, like, Joe talking to a 14-year-old, you know? It's challenging. Not your old Joe. But it's that part of it, the parents become a big part of it because some of the kids don't even really know the questions to ask. You know, like, think about it. You're asking, like, a 14-year-old, what are you thinking about majoring in college? They're like, I don't even know, like, what my sophomore class schedule is yet. So it is really out of control, and I think the parents are playing a bigger and bigger role. And when I say that the parents are playing a bigger and bigger role, it comes down to, like, how you were describing the situation about, well, I really want to commit because it's this one spot, and, you know, I need this spot. Well, the parents are looking at it like, well, if we don't commit quickly, meaning early in the process, like freshman or sophomore year, then scholarship money is not going to be available. I won't be able to go to my first choice school. So I think a lot of times the parents actually push the timeline too because they want security of knowing what that offer looks like. Now, in our sport, we're not all or nothing. So like football, you get either full scholarship or you are a walk-on. In our sport, you can get any percentage, half, a quarter, full, whatever. So I think that also makes us a little bit like used car salespeople because we kind of haggle back and forth. It's like my job is to try and get this kid for the least possible money. The parent's job is trying to get the most possible money. So there's a lot of going back and forth. And I think it's this recruiting has to change. There's going to be a tipping point at some point in our sport because it's just getting earlier and earlier, and it's becoming more and more a problem. We're getting a lot more transfers than we used to. And I think the parents and the coaches, like as coaches, we obviously haven't found a solution to this because we all want to fight and argue about everything. The parents have bought into it too. The club coaches have bought into it because now they're like the agent. You know? So there's a lot of things wrong with recruiting right now. And I think I'm not speaking only for soccer. It seems like particularly a lot of the women's sports are that way because physically, for the most part, players are developed at that age. You know, think of a guy in ninth grade might look very different than to a guy in 12th grade because he hasn't grown as much yet. Most girls don't change, but the problem is things that change are like, do I really love playing soccer? You know, am I committed at this point to that level? And it's something that's got to really change.
Folks, this is crazy.
It is.
Crazy. Talking to a freshman high school? How about college? Really? What kind of sense are you making on this? Yet they have to make a decision, or else she falls further behind, perhaps. This is against the rules of the NCAA. Not really. We find a way. The NCAA is guarded against this. Official visit, Blake? There's no such thing as official visits anymore, and making sure that you find the right fit for you. Because it's already decided. They come on official visit, they come on 48-hour holidays while campus to enjoy themselves for 48 hours. Because they already committed 2-3 years prior to that. So it is really a problem. And we somehow sugarcoat this and don't address it. It is some serious stuff needs to take place to avoid this freshman or these parents being involved because they feel like they have to be involved. I have four things I talk to recruits. What can we do for you academically? What can we do for you athletically? What can we do for you socially? And I will purposely look straight in the little one's eyes. Then when it comes to what can we do for you financially, I will now acknowledge the parent. Because I don't want to hear the parent's side of things. I want to hear the recruit's side of things. So I'm trying to communicate to the recruit, not to the parent. But the parent, of course, needs to be involved in the process as well. But you need to start as early as possible, making lines and putting lines in place to make sure that it's off limits.
for parents to go. And there's certain things you have to allow them to, in this case, the financial side of it has to. So what Becky was describing, it's called equivalency. But in most Olympic sports, not the major, not the men, football, basketball, men and women, the rest of us are called Olympic sports. And in Olympic sports, most of us are, the scholarship is equivalency, which is percentages. 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, and we have 14 full rides in women's soccer. And we get now to fill the roster, we'll play with those 14 to fill the roster of 30 players. So that's really the difference between that, what Becky was describing, that as we call it equivalency sports, which is what Olympic sports are. But it is a big, big problem. Nothing else. We could have the entire discussion just on ethics on that. The ethical side of that.
I think parents have become so much more, and this is really across not just athletics, but involvement in academics and applying for colleges. Parents have become much more involved than they were back in the medieval times when I was playing in college. And I think some of the most disappointing conversations I've ever had are actually with some of the parents of some of the players that I coach. Because there were some really nice parents and some people who I still stay in touch with now. But there are some parents of some of the kids that I coached over the 25 years that I never want to see again. And the biggest disappointment is a parent who, in the recruiting process, says that they want their son or daughter to graduate from your school, and then the next time you talk to them is the beginning of the season, and their son hasn't played or their daughter hasn't played as many minutes as they wanted them to play, and that son or daughter may also be flunking out of school. And they don't want to talk about the son or daughter flunking out of school. They want to find out, why isn't their son or daughter playing? Why isn't their son or daughter starting for you? The sport that I coached, every parent, and particularly now, it's worse now. Particularly now, every kid on scholarship at Georgetown thinks they're going to play in the NBA. I promise you. They think, and their parents know they're going to play in the NBA. And I don't know if any of you watched Georgetown play this past year, but they don't have a whole lot of pros on that team, I can tell you that. And so, to me, that was one of the more disappointing parts. The kids, the entire 25 years that I coached in college, the athletes, the players, that was why I loved coaching, and it's still why I like teaching now, is being involved with young people and watching them grow. And it's amazing how much they do grow. I almost brought a tear to my eye literally yesterday when I heard Allen Iverson talk about Larry Brown. And the light bulb finally went off in Allen's head in terms of his relationship with Larry Brown. And it was a very, I don't know if any of you followed Allen Iverson when he was in the pros, but he and Larry Brown had a very a contentious relationship, but it was a love-hate relationship. And some of the things that Allen said about Larry Brown, you know, I really enjoyed some of the things he talked about. But parents are a big, big part of recruiting now, and they also can be a big, big problem. And everybody in this room and everybody that was in the stands when I coached at Georgetown knew far more than I did, and certainly all the parents did too, and so that is... you want your parents to be involved, but hopefully they're going to be involved in the athlete's entire life, not just how many minutes they're playing or how many shots they're taking.
So along those same lines, then, how often are you dealing with parents? In your experiences in the past and present, how often are you having to deal with these parents in a situation? And then, Blake, from your perspective, how do you manage parents? Because I think a big part of this for the players, right? After a big game, whether you played well or not, whether you played a lot or not, you're having to deal with the parents saying, well, why didn't Coach Twitch win for this amount of time, or why didn't Coach do this? So on the same token, I think it's, you have to have sort of understanding from everybody, right? The coaches have to understand that the parents are involved, the athletes have to understand that they're going to have to manage their parents a little bit, and then we hope that the parents have some understanding in all this as well. But that tends to be have the least amount of understanding about all of this, right? So I guess I'll start with Blake first, just to talk about
how you managed that situation with your parents when you come back to Joe.
I was with my parents. My dad played football his whole life. He had a chance football. My mom's Canadian and knows nothing about football. So she's like, doesn't understand when something goes wrong. I threw an interception. It was somehow someone else's fault. So loving mom, that's great. So I was on my side. But there's that part of the parents thing where you, after every game, you explain every piece of the game to them. I think that the worst parts I had with parents was it was teammates' parents. If you walk down the tunnel and someone would yell down at you stuff, they'd say, why don't you go to my son the ball? Why don't you do this? I think that part of it is definitely tough. But I know actually the recruiting thing was, as an 18-year-old kid, you don't know, one thing is you don't know what questions to ask. I think that's one part of the parents is they know what questions to ask for you. They're saying, hey, Blake, can you ask the coach how their alumni network is? I was like, I don't really care. They're a Nike school. They say, you know, I think it's definitely important having someone who's also mature enough to see, you know, what's really important in what you're doing, to kind of guide you along the way. But in terms of, you know, keeping them, I guess I check sometimes. I think they always try to keep their distance. But I've seen a number of times you see parents walk on the football offices and there's a reason why this guy's dad's here. He's probably not good. So I know as a player I've seen that. I'm sure they're probably much different as a coach as well.
I purposely made sure that I was off limits to parents, and the only time I would talk to a parent was if the player herself talked to me first. We sat down, we talked, we tried to work things out, and I was never going to be surprised by a parent approaching me about anything. If I did not have a conversation with the player and the parent wanted to approach me, I said, nah, she needs to come in and talk to me first. Find out what the issues are, what's the problem, before I can even go down this road. So I just made a thing out that the players would know and then pass it on to the parents, and the parents would know as well. Because for the most part, you don't want to hear that phrase. But if it's needed and we need to reach out to the parents, then of course we're going to do that. But for the most part, this to me was also 18, 22-year-old young adults. It's your turn to get it done. The parents got you here, they've done their job, now it's your turn to step up and get it done. As a student, as an athlete. So they need to take on that ownership. That's part of our job as educators. To make sure that they begin to manage things, including a situation that may not be to their liking, like playing time, this, or that, whatever it is. It is your turn to come in, sit down, talk about it. If it does not get resolved to your liking, and your parents need to be involved in this, then it's not all okay with having that conversation with a parent. But I had 33 years of it. Nah. Not interested.
I have a really simple rule with parents. Is that if any parent, I'm more accessible than Joey's, I think. I say I'm happy to talk to any parent, but if it's about your daughter, then she either has to be present, or if you can't do that because you live far away, then I have a phone in my office that you could conference call. And that eliminates like 90% of it, because they don't really want to talk to you in front of their daughter. They want to talk to you about their daughter with the daughter not there. But I will tell you, like, one thing that Joe and I were kind of talking about this earlier today is, so this is a prime example of what we were discussing. We had a player on our team. There was these two girls who were both playing right back, the right defender for us. And one of them played about 80% of the time, the other one played about 20% of the time. Well, we had really had this big discussion on our team about competition and how the true meaning of competition is from the word competir, it's a Latin word, to strive together. And so we had created this partnership in different places, and these two were considered partners for one another, and they would really support one another. So the one that was playing 80%, when she would come off the field, the first person she would go talk to was the kid that was playing right behind her, and vice versa. So the one that wasn't playing much, her father said to her, like, why are you cheering for this kid that plays in front of you? Like, why are you supporting her? Like, she's your competition. You know, you've gotten complacent. you know, you're not committed to winning this job, like you're complacent in your role. And that was really hard for her because she really looked up to her dad from an athletic standpoint, and it was her dad. And she finally had to sort of put boundaries on her ability to have conversations with her dad about that because she was committed to the whole strive together concept, but he just couldn't wrap his mind around that. And so as an adult, she just said to him, like, we can talk about anything else about soccer or about school or whatever, but we're not talking about my relationship with that player that's playing in front of me. So I think sometimes, like, the players on the team, they get it, they understand it, but then when you get in the car with the parents, like, they kind of, like, put this stuff in your head, like, oh, you should play more, you know. I don't understand why, you know, you don't hit the ball as much, kind of like what you were saying, Blake. So I think that's puts the player in a very, very difficult spot, and I have a lot of empathy for players who are in that situation.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit, and I don't know if this is more for Joe, you and Becky, but international players and international recruiting, and how do you balance the idea of you want to bring international talent to your program, but you also have homegrown talent, and you have boosters and people that are part of your program that feel like that's where you should be spending the bulk of your time.
Because Georgetown has a very well-known foreign service program, and we had, when I was there, we had a lot of international students. And so bringing an international student to a private school like Georgetown was never a problem. It was not unusual in any way, shape, or form. We had a French department, Italian department, Spanish department, and so I would travel. I've been to Russia, been to Senegal, been to Yugoslavia to recruit players, and one of the better players that we got because a State Department employee from Kinshasa, Zaire called us up and said, there's a 7'2 kid that's on the national team, and he's a really good player, and you guys maybe need to take a look at him. And this employee, the State Department employee, was Howard University grad, so he's been familiar with Georgetown's program. And so the first thing, you get a phone call from someone saying, kid's 7'2". Oh yeah, sure, 7'2". Sure. And so he actually came back to D.C. for a couple days to visit, and he came into our office, and we had a player on our team that was 7'1 at the time, and he came into the office that day, and so my boss, John Thompson, said, well, so is this kid taller than the kid that came in the office? His name was Ben Guillory. And he said, oh, definitely tall. Well, the person I'm talking about is Dikembe Mutombo. And he was one of the most unusual human beings I've ever met in my life. And tell me if any of you have done this. The first time he went to a class and the professor didn't show up, he marched down, and I know nobody in here has done this, marched down to the dean's office and said, oh, professor didn't show up. What's going on here at the school here? And so I know all of you just go right back to the door and go back to the school. That's what my students would do. And so Georgetown's not a state school, private school, and certainly the alums were very happy to have brought in somebody like that. And Dikembe was a fantastic person. He's an ambassador now for the NBA, member of the Hall of Fame. And for the most part, I've been pleasantly surprised that the funny thing about international players is they haven't been through some of the recruiting and the AAU system that we have in this country, and their attitude about education, actually seeking an education. I just gave you a perfect example, but Kembe is a little bit different than some of the players we recruited in the United States. And it's not the player's fault, it's the system's fault more than anything else.
The international flavor, well, first of all, soccer is a world sport, as most of you guys have heard, and in the United States, it's relatively new. So we welcome any injection from the international side. The women's game, not as much. Certainly in the men's game, because they bring so much dimension to it. Excellent dimension that we may balance the entire program. Too many of anything is not good. So you can have too many, but at the same time to have a nice blend that brings in and brings a great mix to the what you're trying to do, it's outstanding. So we constantly look for international stuff. International talent becomes, again, if they fit. In the women's game, you gotta be really careful because the athletic thing, they may lack quite a bit. Where in the men's game, they tend to be really, really good. So certain countries, certain parts of the world in women's game still very good. Plus, the United States in women's game, we're kind of pioneers in women's soccer. Whereas the world's, we're in the same page. The world and the United States in women's game, we're in the same page, started playing soccer by the same time. Where the men, there's no way they can catch up, ever catch up to the world. Well, I mean, I keep working hard at it. Because it's so hard. It's so hard. I mean, it's so hard to get years and years of that stuff into the system of a United States player, the mentality that comes with it.
The recruiting process is totally different for internationals. It usually starts with like seeing them on TV or video or something, and then hopefully going over there to see them play live. Some places are easier to go than others, kind of like what you mentioned. I took a trip to Nigeria one time, had no idea what I was doing, but it was entertaining and educational. We had a player for 6 weeks and then she couldn't get her visa. But I like the idea of having international players too. I think that just adds to the education that you get in college. When I played for Joe in college, we had some Irish players on our team. And that definitely brought flavor to our team. We have a Canadian, which I don't really think is international. I guess your mom would probably disagree. And a Slovenian. The Slovenian is definitely, she's a citizen of the world. She's definitely brings a lot different mentality to our team. But I do agree with Joe. On our side, the women international students are exceptional. I know we had a Norwegian student that just recently left our school, and she was an actuary major, which is really, really hard. And she came in and said, "I think my classes are not challenging enough." I was like, "Okay, you can have fun."
So I guess we're going to switch base a little bit here and start talking about the NCAA. Talk about some much more contentious information here, but talk about the NCAA. Talk about the contracts and the scholarships, should they be binding, how long should they be? So the first question I'm going to start with is signing day. I'll start with Blake on the spot first. Thinking about signing day and everything that comes behind that moment in time of having a student athlete on the stage, especially when you think about football, it's done on ESPN now, and it's a big deal. Is that pushing it a little too far when you think about an 18-year-old in front of the cameras making that decision and feeling that pressure to stick with that particular institution for the course of their careers?
I think the whole signing day thing, I mean, it's obviously necessary, but I was just looking at the whole recruiting process for a lot of top recruits, but how many times they switch their commitment? I mean, for a coach, I have to go through that. They would extend signing day even closer to the season, which would make it harder and harder. So I think it's important to have that time there so folks can kind of move on and say, these are our 25 guys taking this class. Because I've seen so many times where guys, they're changing basically by a week. And that's no good for coaches, and that doesn't really do them any good as well.
And sit with Blake for a second. When you think about signing that scholarship, is there anything that should be included that's not included? Is there anything as far as contractually that you should be obligated to do or coaches should be obligated to do? And along these lines is the thinking of you have a player who signs a contract or signs their scholarship in a particular school, and then the coach, should they then always be able to even go to any school they want to, or should they have limits on the schools that they can go to and things like that? So any changes you can make?
I don't know if there's really any changes I'll make in that regard. I think that what I experienced was when I graduated Marshall, or any kid who finished undergrad can look at whatever grad school they want. Because I was a football player, I was bound by that contract. I had a secret approval from my head coach to look anywhere else.
Yeah.
And so when he blocked me from those 114 schools, obviously you're limited by where you can look for grad school, and their student can just look wherever they want. And so I think that part of it, it's obviously kind of like a rather student athlete, but with coach leaving, but that's kind of part of the game. You really shouldn't commit to a coach, really commit to a school. That's the first. That's what you're doing. You're going to school to rack them first. That's not always the case, but I think once again, I think if you change it so student has to leave, when a coach left, it was continue kind of a. I look at it's just a road you don't want to go down.
Well, I think it is a challenge though when a coach leaves, like, and the coach can immediately be employed anywhere, but when the student athlete wants to leave, at least in some sports like football, basketball, you have to sit out a year. So that seems a little contradictory to me. I think that what the NCAA has done in a positive light is they have created now a four-year scholarship, so you can have a multi-year scholarship. It used to be the scholarships were for 1 year, and then you renew them each year. Now you can give a multi-year scholarship, so that the athlete and the parents know exactly how much scholarship money they're going to get, and it's guaranteed for 4 years, unless you like break rules or do something silly. So I think that that's been a positive. Another positive a lot of people have talked about is what's called the cost of attendance. So for people who are full scholarship sports, the cost of attendance averages about probably between $2,000 and $4,000 more than just your tuition, room, board, books, and out-of-state fees. So that's kind of like an added stipend. But then you know, there's still the contentious issue of whether players should be paid. And if that's the case, how do you do that? Do you only pay revenue-generating sports? Do you pay everyone? You know, there's a lot going on right now about teams that appear on television. So if you appear on television, should you get some money from doing that? So I've heard, you know, kind of talk about, like, if your team plays on television, each player, regardless of whether you're playing the game, gets a set amount of money. So let's say that's $10,000 a year. So I think what that would do to sports like ours would, they would just take us off television because they're not gaining any revenue from women's soccer being on television. It's more of an exposure thing. So I have a feeling that would hurt a lot of the Olympic level sports.
I mean, I think you guys are going off on a tangent. So I'm thinking more along the line, these rules are there for a reason. We coaches have used it, John. Those rules that protect the student athlete. Honestly, that book is that thick. To protect the student athlete. Because of what we do in manipulating rules. So when you talk about signing day, for example, it may exist for us, but it's just a facade, it's a stage because we are already committed. So they have, the football and soccer has the same signing day, which is first weekend in February of the senior year. That is when it's official. That's when it's in stone. Now you're now obligated to 1 year minimum at that institute, at that institution. We have in our sport clauses or waves, a waiver that allows you to transfer. But again, these rules are only there to protect the student. Because us coaches can pick up and go the next best offer. And so it still remains that, but should they be getting paid? Wow, sure they're gonna pay the cost of attendance.
Not more. Well,
no, I mean, if you can get paid.
So, but in this particular case, the cost of attendance is about, she said, between 2 and 4. Oklahoma University is still undecided to what extent they're gonna try to step up and pay this cost of attendance, which is another $1 million that they have to come up with to support this concept. And it, for the mid-majors, I'm sure UMass is probably in the same pickle, it's difficult. So what Old Dominion University is trying to do is figure out, is this cost effective? But, and it doesn't leave them at a very poor disadvantage in recruiting. Because now instead of room and board, tuition, fees, books, now you get $3,000 more or $4,000 more for incidentals that occur in your college. That number comes from financial aid. when financial aid estimates your cost of attending a university, they always add. And that's where they come up with that number. So it's another question that says, should we pay the student athlete, whatever? And it becomes really, we will take advantage of any rule you come up with. Us coaches will find some way to take advantage of it. So it's just a matter of tell me what the rules are so we can figure out what to do next. It's not that simple. It's really quite tricky, quite difficult to find the right answer to that.
Short answer is I don't think that athletes should be paid. I do think that anybody that can qualify for the full value of the Pell Grant should get every dime of it. And along with if they're on full scholarship. So if we had a basketball player qualified for a full scholarship, they should, and they fill out a financial aid form and they qualify for the full Pell Grant, they should get that. And they should also get, if we're working off the cost of attendance, they also should do that. I actually think that was a good rule that the NCAA passed, was to increase the way they defined the scholarship. It used to be, when I was in school in the Middle Ages, room, board, books, tuition, and something called laundry money. And back then, and it was my freshman and sophomore year, back then laundry money was $15 a month. And all of you think $15 is not a lot of money. It was a lot of money back then. And I got to the bank on campus the very first day that you could get your laundry money and picked up my check for $15. The end of my sophomore year, the NCAA was going through this whole cost containment thing because of all sorts of universities were having trouble. There was a downturn in the economy. And so they did away, if you can believe it, with the $15. And now Joe's talking about, you know, cost of attendance is now $3,000. It's about that is really an interesting change on behalf of the NCAA.
So the next thing I want to get into is ethical issues in recruiting and dealing with competition from other institutions. What are some problems or issues that you come into contact with when you think about other institutions that compete for players? And there's this coach out there with Patino and some things that have happened at an institution with recruiting that, again, may be seen as unethical. So the question I pose to you all is, could you tell us about some different scenarios you've run into where you're competing with an institution and maybe having to deal with some of those unethical things?
I think you cannot legislate ethics. There's rules all spelled out, contracts that the player, the host has to sign, the staff person has to sign before a student comes on campus on official visit. There's rules to prevent stuff like that from occurring. But of course, we always take it to the next level of things. So in place already are these rules. We should avoid all this. This stuff should never happen. But of course it happens. Because they're always working on it. Craig, this will be right up your alley, I think. I hope. I think as educators, as teachers, big time ethics involved. As coaches, we push the line. The flame thing, the PSI thing, hopping around this place, right? I'm a big Patriots fan, by the way. That's pushing the line. Is it cheaters, as the rest of the country believes that we are? Right? Is it? What is it? So there's always these grays of interpretation. Us coaches, the coaches have it. I always say this. I would guest speak at a sports management class, coaching philosophy class, and I always start the class with a controversial, provocative little statement. And eventually I would justify or explain to me what I thought I was. I wanted to be a teacher first, coach second. Versus coach first, win at all costs, teacher second. And who do you want to be? A teacher first, coach second, or a coach first, teacher second? And I think we college coaches today, especially today, administrators want you to be teaching ethics. You want results. Which is really sad. This is at the name, in the name of education. It's really, to me, it's really sad state where we're at in terms of that. So ethics in teaching versus coaching, I think it is the job of teachers and educators to strongly support the ethics side of things, the ethical side of things, and on the flip side, coaches are just going to get results. So they push the grade, they push the lines, they push the rules. They're looking for ways to. So does that justify Louisville? Absolutely not. That's crazy what they did. That is crazy. But somehow those rules are already in place to prevent that from happening, they just went over the top.
Well, Joe and I were talking again earlier about this, and I said, we drove together. Not from Florida, just from the airport. So we were saying, like I said to him, so what does an athletic director mean if he says, or she says, well, I think, talk about a coach, I think he's about all the right things, but I'm just not sure he can get it done. What do you think they mean by that? Anybody?
Let's get it done.
When, right? So, and they might be about all the right things, so they might be about teaching character or ethics or whatever to their players, but ultimately the evaluation comes in delivering the outcome. So basically a coach's job is to meet or exceed the level of expectations about outcomes at your school. So I want you to think about this. Let's just say your star player is 20 minutes late to the bus. If you're paid to deliver outcomes, what would you do? Versus if you're paid to create character in your players, what would you do? And I think you can probably answer that in your head and think that might be two very different things. And so I think sometimes the coaches are sent very mixed messages, or maybe not even mixed messages, but that the outcome is what's important. And so that a lot of times is what gets us into these ethical dilemmas. So the situation at Louisville, in case you didn't know, I think he had strippers for the recruits, who knows what else, professional women. You know, so maybe he felt like that was the only way he was going to get this kid. And maybe this kid was so important to their success that he was going to help them deliver outcome. Obviously, he was not in a position to be teaching character in that moment, but I'm not sure that's what he's being evaluated on. So I'm not excusing the behavior in any way, but I think you can see where ethical dilemmas come in when the messenger says that you're paid to deliver outcomes.
And on the same lines, Becky, how much control do you have over the recruiting process as a head coach? And how much of that do you say to your assistants, we have this big time recruit, you take care of it, I'll meet them and their parents back at the end of the weekend? How is that process?
Well, I think every staff does it very differently, but I think that most head coaches, especially if it's like you're saying, this big recruit, are probably very, very involved in that whole process from beginning to end, I would imagine. At least we are, I am. You know, I think one of the things that's handicapped us in the recruiting process, I mentioned about the early recruitment. Well, we used to be able to do a home visit. Okay, a home visit was when you go visit someone at their house, get to meet their family, usually had a meal or something over there, so you got to see them interact. And you can only do that when players are seniors. So our kids are already committed at that point, so no one's making a decision by the time they're seniors. So you can do a home visit now, but like Joe said, it's kind of just a social visit at that point. So we miss that, you know. So now what happens is you have kids come on campus for what is an unofficial visit. Well, they have to pay for that themselves. Think about just the socioeconomic disadvantage that puts some people at. Like, maybe there's a kid here in Massachusetts that really wants to go to Florida, but they can't afford to come to Florida on a trip that they have to pay for by themselves. And then, most importantly, think about the age of these kids that we're recruiting, 14 and 15. I know it's hard to put yourself in the role of a parent, but if you want your 14 or 15-year-old daughter hanging out on the weekend at a college campus, that's kind of scary. And so there's just so many potential pitfalls with what could happen, like where things could go bad. And I think a lot of the coaches should take a lot of responsibility, but I think that the entire system is part of that issue.
If I may add to that, I think the NCAA can do some stuff that would help prevent some of this. We no longer have access to admissions office. We coaches don't have access to admissions office. We don't have access to financial aid offices because we put too much undue influence on these people trying to make decisions. That's an NCAA rule. We have department staff people who represent our wishes there. Compliance should be out of the athletic offices. It should have to be present in the university. Let compliance branch of this answer to the president. Let compliance do their job to enforce these contracts that the student host has to sign, staff person has to sign. Let the president of the university oversee, in my opinion, oversee that branch of college athletics. And I have another one I would love to add to that mix. Academic advising should come under the president's guidance. But there's some serious stuff happening there too. That's not very ethical. And I think having the president more involved in what's happening in athletics, to me, it's a win-win-win situation. As a matter of fact, they need to take back some of the institutions because they are educators. You know what the highest paid basketball coach is in the country? College. Coach K, $9.66 million a year. Highest football coach, Coach Saban, $7 million a year. Who runs the university? The president who makes probably not even $1 million a year? I know it's such a big business. I would love to see. I know, short of that happening, which I don't think is going to happen anytime in the near future because the money is so big, is us being a place of higher learning where the priority is in the student student part. We have gotten so far away from that, in my opinion, especially at the big time, that somehow these presidents need to kind of grab hold of and take back their university. That's my 31 years of experience. I'll have to hear some of them.
Are you ready? You all, thank you. Everybody, all the students in here, you're trained to be managers. And when you manage a department, you're responsible for that department. And I want to kind of follow up with something that Becky said. If you're the president of a university, you're managing that university, you're responsible for what happens at that university. And what disappoints me, and I won't talk specifically about what exactly is going on at Louisville, but what disappoints me as much as anything is the lack of clear statements from the president of universities like this and the athletic directors at universities like this when something like this happens. Clearly, you shouldn't be running a brothel or a strip joint in a dormitory. Okay, and that needs to be said more clearly than it's been said by the people up here. And what Becky said it, what do you want at your university? What do you want your university to represent? Or is it just important? And coach, believe me, the coach here is what is important. If you clearly tell the coach, I want students to graduate, I want students to be good citizens of this university, I want students to represent this university well when they leave, the coach will hear that. But if all you're being paid for is to win football, basketball, soccer, whatever sport it is, games, the coach is going to hear very clearly why you're being paid. Very clearly.
So What do you think needs to happen to change this situation? Because it seems like everyone's pretty much hands off. So the president may not want to say anything because maybe they don't want to lose recruits. Maybe they don't want to say the wrong thing that makes it seem like this is no longer that place that you're going to go to and have that 48 hours of fun. This isn't a place that you're going to go to and maybe have some extra benefits or things that you know the big time recruits have this expectation for them. So whose job is it to step up and say something in these cases? Is it the president? Is it the athletic director? Who's going to change that culture? So I guess you pretty much answered the question of who should say something, but how is that culture going to change in college athletics, the culture of ethics and shit?
Well,
no, I think that's a really hard question because it's there's a lot of responsibility we had in that, and I think you know the message that we get often is protect the brand, right? Protect the brand, and that means like for us, like the Gator brand. And I think kind of to build off a little bit about what Joe was saying, we're not talking about like enhancing the brand. We're talking about protecting the brand. I mean, don't do something stupid that's going to bring us bad reputation. And I think that until the money is different, no, I'll speak first for like women's athletics. Like, you know that prior to Title IX, there were a lot more women coaching women's sports. And the reason was because there was no money in it. And then Title IX came, and all this money came into women's sports. And now, you know, in soccer, soccer's one of the worst sports. I think we're at like 30-something percent of women's teams are coached by women. And I think that when the money goes up, the stakes go up. And as long as these sports, like I don't even call it sports, I just call it entertainment. Like as long as entertainment is big business, I don't think that that situation is going to change anytime soon.
I think just basically with all the minds involved in all sports, these coaches are basically CEOs of that business, of that brand. And I would say that the athletic department is the front court of the university, and they represent what the university does. So if something has to change, it has to be these university presidents that decide. We can't have these bad things happening that are damaging our brand. Because these coaches, as long as they're being evaluated based on like how many wins they have, or the AD, the wins equal additional revenues, then these coaches are going to do whatever they want, whatever they can do to make sure they're the best players to get more wins, more revenues. And really, I think it has to be the university presidents that really make the change.
One second. Blake and I were just talking a minute ago about this guy, PJ Fleck, who coaches at Western Michigan. And I was talking to him recently, and he said, "I am fully aware at some point I will be fired for winning 10 games." And that just happened, right? Mark Rick, Georgia, fired for winning 10 games pretty regularly. And so sometimes, like, as coaches, we sort of light the fire that burns us. So, like, in PJ's case, he first year he gets there, they're 1-11. Next year, they have their first winning season. Next year, they win their first bowl game. And the expectations just keep increasing as he wins. And so eventually, at some point, he'll get fired for winning 10 games. And that sounds crazy, but we've already seen it happen. And again, that goes back to the results and the money.
I think the answer is quite simple. At least we can talk about it now in their own terms. Probably really hard to do. The mission statement of the university needs to match the mission statement of the athletic department. I've been part of the committee to establish, to revisit a mission statement of the college. It took us entire day to construct a sentence. I couldn't believe it. We spent so much time in this mission statement to construct one sentence, making sure everything fits just properly for the mission of that college. And I think every university has a mission statement. It just doesn't match the academic statement. And if the two at least be working hard, the president insists on that mission statement of the athletic department needs to be a branch of, it must, will continue to be done as a slippery slope.
It's look what just happened in March Madness. Great television, wasn't it? It was great television. So what's the chance of this even get higher and higher and higher? Because the money is there. A lot of it. A lot of it. And that's what's happening. The money dictates most of the stuff. At the expense of education. The cost of education today is crazy. You've got to make it all in the news. So I don't have time to wrap my head around that. So.
I was just getting ready to say, I had a conversation with one of your classmates coming over here, and Neff and I talked about this too. I know that when we're up here talking, we're a lot of what we're saying, we're talking about the negative aspect of college athletics. But I'd like to tell you all that I worked in college athletics for 25 years, and I enjoyed all 25 years of it. And there were some ups and downs, no question about it. But those of you that haven't decided yet what you want to do after you graduate, there are a lot of jobs in athletic departments around this country. And even if you're dead set on working in professional sports, you need to think very seriously about working in college athletics. And I'll just give you one example, and he's a graduate of this school. There was a guy that was a basketball manager for the basketball team when I was an assistant coach at Georgetown. In fact, he was at Georgetown when Allen Iverson was there. And through his association with our basketball team, he decided, I want to get involved in the sports industry. I'll work in the sports industry. He got a business degree from Georgetown. He graduated, came here, and got his master's from UMass, got an internship with the Montreal Expos, and was hired by Cleveland Indians, and was with their spring training office, then assistant to the assistant GM, then assistant GM, then GM, and now Chris Antonetti is the president of the Cleveland Indians. But he started as the basketball manager at Georgetown University, and I can give you 100 stories like that. You may want to think about getting, particularly, there's only 122 major professional sports teams in this country, NHL, NBA, Major League Baseball, and NFL. You may want to think about getting your foot in the door in the industry in college athletics. I'll give you another example. Assistant Sports Information Director when I was at Georgetown. The guy's name was Alex Martins. Sports Information Director. You must have six or seven. How many Sports Information Directors are there here at the point that you mentioned?
There's
okay, and so probably interns. There's plenty of people, there's plenty of work to do with all the sports that you have here, and it's a great way, Sports Information Office is a great way to get your foot in the door here. So Alex Martins leaves Georgetown, becomes the Sports Information Director somewhere else, goes and is Communications Director for somewhere else. Alex Martins, just like Chris Antonetti, president of the Orlando Magic, started off in college athletics as an assistant SID, and then just moved his way around the business, and now is the highest, other than the owner, paid employee. Well, he doesn't make as much money as some of the players, I'm sure. But Alex Martins makes a very good living as the president of the NBA team, the Orlando Magic. So just think about it.
The college degree is difficult, but college athletics is nice.
No question.
So the question that I want to end with, or the topic that I want to end with, and then we'll open it up to, I'm sure you have a lot of good questions, is social media and the role of social media in recruiting, and how social media has perhaps made recruiting more difficult. And Blake, you talked about your experiences with social media and being recruited and how that influenced the process.
Let me just say one thing. I am glad I'm not coaching it. With social media, I don't know. I have no idea what I would do.
That's the same about playing.
I have no idea what I would do.
I can't imagine playing and having a bad game and then having to, you know, just pick up your phone and you get all the notifications of people just tweeting at you or Facebooking you and the difficulty of that.
I've had that a couple times, and it definitely is not fun. You're like, have a bad game, you have a bunch of notifications, you're like, oh, what is this going to be? read them all and then screenshots into your friends, and you're like, this is terrible. But that's the way it goes. People love, they love football, they care about it a lot. But just with recruiting, I know Twitter wasn't as big back in my high school days, but just like just with Facebook messages back and forth all the time with coaches. Every time you open on Facebook, you would know from a coach and to a point where it's it started to get annoying. And I know like there's the negative part of social media, but I know just for myself, where now you're not only just representing yourself, you're representing the football team, the athletic department, for me, Iceberg as well. So you have to be so careful about what you say. You can't, you know, retweet something bad, tweet something that's not right, it's where you know, other people may have the freedom to say what they want. You have to be so careful what you
do. Is that a lot of pressure? Because I feel like there's so much more pressure. If you eliminate a social media, then that would eliminate the whole process of you trying to think about every tweet that you send to make sure that you're representing Eisenberg and McCormick and UMass Athletics and all those other different affiliations as well.
I think it's definitely, I mean, just as long as you're kind of scared having an opinion on certain topics,
yeah.
You're thinking, hey, I can't tweet about a presidential candidate just because I want people to say, well, this guy's a Republican or Democrat and I'm not, so I don't like him. And then you just, as an example, you're kind of scared to do that. And you're just so careful what you tweet because you don't want to have people trolling you on Twitter and saying things about you. And plus, like after a good or bad game, there's always people that know more about football than you do. And they're not shy about it. They're more accepting of it.
I actually really like social media. I do. And I like it from a lot of reasons. And one, I think it gives you a chance to really decide what you want to put out there, you know, so people know what you're about by following you and vice versa. So, you know, sometimes like as soon as we're interested in someone, I'll start following them and it gives me an idea of what I'm kind of dealing with. And I think that helps in the recruiting process know things that in the past I would have never known. And sometimes it's just education. So I'll give you an example. We had a kid that we were recruiting who now plays on our team actually. And when we started first recruiting her, I went to her Twitter page, started following her, and her profile picture was a picture she had, like a selfie she had taken in the mirror. And she has really long hair, and her hair was down, but she wasn't wearing anything. And I'm like, okay, this is not gonna work. Now, like, you couldn't see anything, like, it wasn't a lewd picture or anything, but, like, just the idea of the picture. So I was like, called her club coach, I'm like, this is not a good idea, like, just, you might want to let her know that, like, we don't think this is a good picture. Well, like, the next day she changed her picture. And so, like, some of it's just education, like, you can't really expect people to know right away, but I think once you kind of set standards and ideas, but then you kind of also get a little bit of an unfiltered view of kids, because I don't think they're thinking that much about what they put on social media, so you kind of get a truer picture of what's out there. So yeah, there's some challenges to it, but I personally like it.
Overall, would you say it's helped in the recruiting process? Has it helped you get to feel like you get to know the players a little bit better before bringing them on campus?
I think they get to know me better. Like I think what is important for me is like, are the messages consistent? So, and what am I saying to them in the recruiting process? Is that matching up with what they're seeing of me on social media and vice versa? So what they're telling me is important to them, is that lining up with what they're putting on social media? And so for me, it's, you know, it's a transparency issue. So I don't see it as a bad thing.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
I'm not a fan of social media.
Two reasons.
That's because Joe's font is like this big on his phone, and like if you're sitting in the seat behind him, you can be wrong.
Did you guys pick up on what she said?
That was
Did you pick up what she said a little bit a while ago? I called the coach.
Well, I can't call her. She's too young.
She cannot communicate with these kids yet. So she has to call the club coach. Most kids, this is high school coach, but usually the club coach, to tell the club coach to tell her to clean up her act. I had a story as well. I'm like, what? We're tracking these people before they even come on campus. My compliance, this is scholarship signing time, right around where we submit the NLI to the office. They send out national letter of intent, and they send it out to the prospects that we're signing. And my compliance calls me in and says, "This one of your kids." She went to her Facebook page and starts looking at all the photos. So, yeah, that's the one we're about to sign. Yes, she has her papers in hand. In 10 days from now, it's official. She'll be a monarch. He says, "Well, I think we need to do something about this." So before the kids even on campus, our compliance officers are already onto this social media stuff to the point where I got called into the principal's office before you even arrived on campus. I'm having to justify you before you even got here, and then I have to tell you that this has got to go. And it became almost like, wow, what a wake up call that we are absolutely in your business before even you arrive. I have another philosophy. I think student athletes have no rights. I think they should have rights. They have no voice, they have no representation in all the stuff that we do and the money that they bring in, yet they have no representation, so to speak, besides the NCAA. NCAA has no representation, including this social stuff, personal stuff. We are in your business. I'm troubled by that too. I'm troubled. I have to track that. I have to track your social side of your private, what I consider to be your private life, so you don't embarrass the brand, so you don't embarrass the university, yourself, and whatnot. So we're having to police that again before we even talk to you. How that works, folks, is that we contact the club coach, "Hey, we're really interested." From the student to us, there's no rules. But from us to the students, student athletes, there's all kinds of rules. That thick. But a student can call us, student can come and visit, we can talk if they initiate it until certain dates in recruiting. And so when Beck is recruiting freshmen, high school freshmen, 14-year-olds, sophomores, 15-year-olds, she's not allowed to contact them at all unless they initiate. And again, she's not allowed to respond. So if they come on campus, they pick up a phone and call, and you can talk. And that's where we're at. It's pretty silly. But that's where we're at, and somehow we need answers, we need to fix, quick fix, because this continues to escalate, because everybody doesn't want to be outworked. They constantly keep pushing us. It used to be juniors, official visits, in-house visits. Here we come with a joke, absolute concept, in-house school, which is really, and again, panelists.
Take it back. I just want to say one thing really quick. So, like, here's the difference between being a pro coach and being a college coach. So a college player on a team gets in trouble for doing something. And like Joe mentioned, as a coach, you get called on the carpet for that as a coach because you are responsible for the talent you bring to your university. Pro player gets in trouble for doing something. You never hear about the coach being responsible. They get fined. Maybe they cut them, you know, wave them, whatever. But the coach is not responsible for the talent because the GM brings in the talent there, not the coach. So the coach has a lot of responsibility of things that they have no control over. And I think that in itself becomes a big dilemma.
So I'm going to tell you a funny story about that. My wife is a longtime prosecutor where we live in Arlington County. And when I was the head coach at Georgetown, I would get some, speaking of being responsible, some 1:30 in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning phone calls about some things that would happen with my players. And we got a phone call the other night, and I kind of had a flashback. Phone call was at 4:30 a.m., and there was a murder in Arlington County, and my wife had to wake up, put her clothes on, and go to the murder site, and then had to go interview the person who they think committed the murder. And I was thinking back to when we get a phone call in my sick, twisted mind as the head coach at Georgetown University, I'm thinking, please let there be a murder in Arlington County. Not one of my players in jail. Please let that happen.
So at this point, I think we want to open it up. Before we open it up, is there any last comments or thoughts that anyone wants to say? If not, we'll open it up to the audience to ask some questions. Yeah, Brian.
So, I was more agreeing with one topic that was kind of discussed a lot, those coaching salaries and how those have kind of escalated over the last several decades. And I don't personally disagree that that's something that's certainly a very heated issue today, but maybe kind of play devil's advocate. What kind of power do you think Roman and Google have played in that escalation over the last several years?
The big players, money talks, and they know it walks. And that's exactly what's happening here. Everybody's chasing the dollar. It's a business. It's bottom line business. And again, I don't have a problem with the bottom line business. That's what pro teams do. I have a problem at the expense of education. So I think from that perspective, those, no question, there are major players in this. Major players as in, that's where the money is. And then all you have to do is follow that.
But Les Miles, LSU this year. Right? So he almost got fired because probably more than one booster wanted to make that change. And then someone intervened. I don't know what happened there. But I do think that's part of it. I think, but here's also, think of this, like, I think it was Blake who mentioned, like, the coach is sort of like the CEO, right, of their company. So think about this one. All right, maybe you're the CEO of your company. You have, what is there, 100 guys on football team? So you've got 100 guys, 25 of whom leave at least every 4 years, right? So some more than that because they might leave early or whatever. And you get 25 new employees every year. Like, do you see the challenge of being a CEO in that environment? And sometimes it's your best talent that leaves. So I think as a person who's in charge of that multi-million-dollar business, and you have this turnover, and you have, you know, and that's 100 players is just players. You're not even talking about staff. But at Florida, we just got a new football coach, and it's amazing, like, the staff we have. We have, like, a special teams coach, but then we have a quality control for special teams. I don't even know what that means. And we have that in, like, every category. So, you know, the CEO is having to oversee not only just his players, but all this staff that contributes to that. And so, you know, are they worthy of those salaries? I mean, the market drives it, right? I mean, if people weren't so interested in seeing college football, we wouldn't have, you know, Saban making $7 million a year or Coach K making $9 million a year. But the market drives it, and it's hard to argue that.
Has there ever been a time where you had to make the hard decision of revoking or reducing someone's scholarship and what their stance on for your scholarships versus renewable money?
Why did you ask that question? No, I was just talking about that. Yes, I have had to
do that. Just
yeah, I have. Yes, and that's always a really hard discussion because when someone loses a scholarship, it has to be pretty major, in my opinion, for that to happen. And that's something that I would definitely involve the parents in that discussion because it's obviously kind of a life-altering situation in terms of being able to continue to attend at that university. I think that the idea of the four-year scholarships is a really good idea. I never really liked the idea of this one-year renewable thing because I think what we were starting to see in our sport was players losing money based on how they produced athletically. That's really difficult, you know, like if you're on a 75% scholarship and then you have a bad year and now you're on a 25% scholarship, I don't think that's fair. So I think the idea of having these four-year scholarships has been a big improvement in the NCAA.
She's an exception to the rule. She's an exception to the rule because there are some dumping mistakes left, right, and center.
Yeah.
That's called a mistake.
They call it buyer's remorse. That's even bad in the NBA.
So dumping mistakes is very common practice. It should not happen. Again, in this environment, in my opinion, it should not happen.
So that simply means, no, it's not what. And you're not starting for us, you're not good enough. You need to find another place. It's some of the things that we get away with is pretty shocking. Again, lack of student representation in this process. I think students have more say. I would think it would help immensely making sure that, no, you need to give me reasons. It could be social. It could be academic, of course. Institution makes that policy. As far as if you have to be dropped from the program, academically, that's fair enough. That's straightforward. Nobody has an issue with that. It could be socially. But in terms of being don't go to the state, what we call the state, you're just not good enough for us. You made a mistake in your recruiting. She's having to commit when you're a freshman. Well, sophomore.
Going to Las Vegas, same thing.
Yeah. You're having to commit. And what's going to happen in 3 years from now when she shows up as a freshman who's on whatever percentage of scholarship? And all of a sudden, it's not working out. It's not happening. It's a tough one in terms of having, and because the pressure is to win, they don't. And they will suffer the consequences from that, which is a bad reputation. Some programs have bad reputations because they don't get mistakes. Others, like Becky, will try to eventually discourage or to move on.
But you know what though, I don't think some people get a bad reputation because people don't want to talk about that. No one's going to go around and say, hey, yeah, this coach caught my scholarship because I suck. You know, like no one's going to really admit to that. So I don't think those programs get a bad reputation, which allows them to do it even more.
I've seen pursuits have like big role in politics or anything that money with this part of the side. As a coach, how do you deal with the relationship with those pursuits, making sure they are making no good ethical decisions? As an athlete, how do you deal with pursuits?
I say from my experience, I never really had, I guess the football team, the administrative group is all kind of keeping that distance there. But there's also, there's always a time where there's some booths they recognize, you're at dinner and he says, hey, let me care for you. Like, not be able to, like, not, you're a pro college kid, you have no money. And of course, you would love them to do that, but you know that that's something you can't do. And so, and obviously, you keep those relationships because those guys, those ladies and gentlemen, they want to be around the athletes. That's the reason why they get money. They love to be around the athletes. They want to see what you're all about. But I guess making sure that you keep your distance as well, and make sure that you're not getting yourself in trouble. If it's not hurting them, it's hurting you by doing that. By putting yourself in that situation.
Yeah, I don't really deal with boosters that we don't have to fundraise it for them, so we're pretty fortunate in that sense. We do some, events where we hang out with the boosters, but that's more social. But I do think that it's more about educating the athletes. So it's little things like go to a club and the guy wants to waive your chart, your cover, because you're an athlete. Like, that's illegal, and players need to be aware of that. A local sports bar can't have, Florida soccer night. Anyone from Florida soccer gets it free to watch a Champions League game. That's illegal. So it's more just educating athletes about the little things that seem kind of nonchalant and like you really want to take them, but aware that you could jeopardize your eligibility by doing stuff like that.
You're the manager and you're responsible, and you have to make certain that your players know what they can and cannot do, and you have to keep the boosters at arm's length, and you have to be responsible for keeping them at arm's length. At Georgetown, last couple of years, I spent almost as much money going out to try and raise money for the university as I did recruiting players. Because the university, it's a private university, we didn't have taxpayer money coming in. And so all the coaches in every sport had to go, part of their job responsibility was they had to go out and build relationships with Georgetown alums and some of the local business people. But I made it very clear to stay away. And did everything I could to find out if anybody didn't listen. What Blake was saying, though, is important. You want them to be involved because when their careers are over, you want your alums to hire or at least interview your players or help them get a job. So you can't offend people. But you got to make certain that, look, you're really going to hurt a kid and you're going to put me in a bind if you do something like this. Here are the rules. And we would send out to anybody that was closely involved in any way, shape, or form. If somebody had hired somebody in the summer, we sent something out and let them know very clearly what exactly the rules were and what they were doing.
Other questions? Yes.
Hey, this is about commitment. You talk about a 14-year-old committing to your school. A, how does a 14-year-old commit to your school, and how do you solidify that commitment? How do schools solidify a commitment that, in judgment of a 14-year-old?
It is a verbal commitment. It is not binding whatsoever. It's my word and my integrity. I can show where your integrity. And in some sports, it's quite good. The integrity side of that is quite good. In some sports, not so good. I think she goes a step further with it. Because we have to talk money for the commitment, but yet how do you talk money for 14, 15 years? And you can't put it in writing because it's not me. So it becomes, well, I'll let her handle this since I didn't recruit 14, 15 year olds. The reason why I'm retired.
It's the reason why a lot of people retire. Well, first of all, the way it works is they just say, I want to commit. And you say, okay, great, that's awesome. And then you babysit them for the next 4 years. And when I say babysit, it means like you're still going to all their games and watching them and staying in as much contact as you can legally and all that kind of stuff. But I think that's one rule that's really bad about the NCAA is that you can't give them you can't write down an offer, because I feel like that doesn't help the institutions or the parents, because I think they're, you know, it leaves a lot of room for interpretation there. What you can do is you can say, okay, this is what we're going to offer you, and tell them verbally, and they write it down. Seems really weird, but like that's kind of what happens. And I think that what there's been a lot of talk in soccer. Soccer is, again, not alone, but it's definitely a leader in bad recruiting as far as this early stuff. And so everybody kind of argues with the model of football how people are changing their minds until the last minute. And I get that because, like, the word commitment in football, like, what does that even mean? Our football staff tells me that when someone commits, they just know who their competition is now. That's what they say. So that kid's not going to stay with that commitment, probably, more than likely. They know who their competition is. So what we've talked about in soccer is, like, kind of taking away, like, this word commitment, or, like, if you're going to say you're committed, okay, that's fine. But your recruitment is still open until you sign in February of your senior year. And so now it's not like this ethical breach or violation that you are still recruiting someone after they're committed. But at the same time, you know, like, let's say I'm a really late bloomer, and so I commit to a lower level school, and by the time I am a senior, I am like, I should be going to a top level school. Well, I have that ability to have that upward mobility. But if you want to have it that way, then you got to have it both ways, which is, when I was a freshman, I was, you know, awesome, and I was the best player ever, and by the time I'm a senior, I'm kind of disinterested. And so the school can say, you know what, we're moving on from you. Because I think that happens in football a lot, where a guy gets an offer, and then he doesn't always have that offer until he's a senior, because their boards change. And in football in particular, they over-recruit. I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. For the over-recruiting thing, most schools will take about 30 guys, and kind of the whole thing where they, if you're not good enough, they kind of try to find ways to beat you out. That's not ethical in any way. But the one thing is that the student athlete's fault if they're not good enough? It's not the coach's fault for bringing them to school in the first place. So the kid came there thinking they have a chance to go to school, get a degree, play for 3 or 4 years, and have a great college experience. But now they're not considered good enough. Now there's ways to kind of get them to leave. And obviously that's not the right way to do it.
I think it just happens where they over, like, is it 25 is the limit for your class? But, you know, they recruit 30. Somebody's they're banking on somebody not qualifying academically, maybe, but they're also banking on the fact that, okay, we're only going to keep our top 25 and those last five we're jettisoning. That's really crappy, but like that's what happens.
I noticed myself, I committed the summer going to my senior year because I said, if I get hurt, I'm going to make sure I have somewhere I can go. So I was so scared about that. But still, if I would have gone out there and broke both my legs, they really still had no obligation to me. I could never go play football again. And they could have said, sorry, you know, best of luck on the road. There's no real, you know, commitment from them. You know, we agreed it was a verbal commitment, but that really didn't mean anything.
And like the injury thing, folks, it's no one. If it's not in writing, we can back out at any time. Which means, again, you lose. But that basically is, you take knees, particularly in our sports, it could be quite severe and could be throughout the next 3 years that she's babysitting. And all of a sudden it is, and the setback is severe. It's not back to what it was. Chances are they're going to back out of that online commitment. It's just verbal. Right? If it's officially on paper and then an injury occurs, it's fine. So university, the athletic department, Becky may not have to use one of our 14 scholarships on the kid, but the university picks up the tab on that if it's life-threatening injury or an injury where they can no longer play. So there's even rules for that. Because of that, but not until it's official, which is February of senior year. That's when it's done, that's signing in.
We've talked about some bad things. Don't forget, there's an awful lot of good things. This is a great place to work. And as Winston Churchill said, democracy may be a terrible thing, but what's better than democracy? College athletics may be terrible in terms of the way it's organized right now, but I have not thought of a better way to organize it than the way we've organized it right now. It can be improved, but those of you that are still thinking about what you want to do for a living, think about college athletics.
And recruiting reform. One of you could make recruiting reform.
So please join me in thanking our guests for coming today. Coaches and experiences on this stage. So I think we can be very thankful for that. ADS, thank you guys. And ladies for bringing in these people for the panel. It was a great panel. I think, especially at UMass, we're so focused on professional sports that we don't have a lot of opportunities like this to bring in people from the college and collegiate level. So it's nice to have this caliber of guests, but also to talk, have a space to talk about college sports. So again, thank you all, and thank you all for coming today.